Here we go.
And welcome to Full On Football, the show that promotes all branches of the round ball game played in South Australia. My name is Nat Adamopoulos, and like I do always, I'd like to introduce my partner in crime. Good evening to Michael Brooks.
Good evening, Nat. How are you?
Oh, I'm very good. How did you enjoy your game on Friday night?
Yeah, it was a tough game, but managed to get through with a point, so we're happy with that, I suppose.
Yeah, well, at least you didn't lose, so at least you did get a point.
That's the main
thing. And you do need them. So would you like to let everyone know who's on the show tonight?
Certainly would, Nat. Coming up on tonight's show, we have Ross Aloisi, the captain of the Adelaide United Football Club, Carmine Lauriello, the assistant coach of the Campbelltown Red Devils, Peter Cristarella, the coach of the Enfield City Falcons. We have Shaun Claridge from the White City Woodville U23 team, Shannon Claridge, his brother, from the Western Strikers U13s, and Shaun Nelligan from the chairman of the Parafield Gardens Football Club. But it is my great pleasure to introduce our guest panellist. He is a OAM, Order of Australian Medal, most recognised honoured referee in SA football history. He officiated in local, state, national and international games, including the World Cup Olympic qualifiers. In 1974, he was the first SA referee to be awarded the FIFA badge. Only referee in the Southern Hemisphere to have refereed all three South American World Cup winning teams, Brazil, Uruguay and Argentina. He was the NSL Referee of the Year on three consecutive occasions in 85, 86, 87. He's an SA Football Hall of Famer, host of Coast FM Talking Football. It is my great pleasure to introduce to you Donald Campbell. Donald, welcome to Full On Football.
Thanks, mate. Good evening to you and good evening tonight. It's a good pleasure
evening
to be here.
Oh, thanks very much for coming on. Whew, you take a breath now after
have you
all
done
that.
All that in your life, Donald?
No, I think I just wrote it out for you, Michael.
And also, he's an Australian Football Hall of Fame as well,
Australian
aren't
football,
you?
Sorry, yes. I did miss that one out, Donald.
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's nice important to be, you know, recognised for what you've done in the game, but I don't think anybody that plays the game or referees the game are in it for recognition. But if it happens, then obviously you don't knock it back because it's a great honour to be involved in the World Game.
Yeah, well, you're very humble, very, very humble, Donald.
Some CV, Donald. What would be your most rewarding achievement out of all of that I've just mentioned then?
Yeah, Michael, it would be difficult to individualise one, but I think, you know, being a boy from Glasgow as I was, I think I refereed Glasgow Rangers, and being brought up in that fanatical environment, I thought when they came here and played Glasgow Rangers, I thought that was something I wanted to do. I'd love to do it, and I did do it, and I was very happy, and South Australia did win the game 2-1.
Mm. With some help from yourself, Donald.
Oh, well, you had to give a penalty in the last minute, Michael, otherwise you don't get recognised. But all the other internationals, referee in Brazil against Argentina, that was a fantastic game. That was in the Australian Bicentennial Gold Cup. Refereeing people like Maradona in Korea, that was a great thrill. Refereeing people like Georgie Best, Franz Beckenbauer, you know, world famous names, Romario, people like that, Michael Brooks even, but they're not.
Comedy's not one of your biggest aspects.
Ross Aloisi. No, I think just being involved in the World Game, I think you have to be humble because it's a game that you're only a small part of.
And I think, Donald, one moment in your career that you will remember forever and ever, I think people will be looking at this photograph we're going to show on the screen. The last time you stepped out as a referee in 1989, the West End Cup final, Hellas and the Lion.
Yes, USC Lion. In fact, my son Graham was playing for USC at that particular game, and I actually cautioned him in the game for bringing down Mark Brazzali. But yeah, it was an eventful night. It was lovely. It was great to be honoured by your fellow peers, the other referees, and I was really thrilled to have a guard of honour, so to speak. I think it was maybe trying to protect me from the spectators.
And Donald, does it seem like nearly 20 years ago when you refereed your last game?
Yeah, well, in actual fact, Michael, it's 16 years ago, and you know, it's unbelievable how quickly those years have gone. I've kept involved in the game in many aspects, and I've been continuing to referee five-a-side soccer. And somebody asked me how many games have I refereed, and I think 11 a-side games, probably around 4,000 games. So I think that's as good as you can get.
It's not a wonder your knees are like they are, Donald.
My knees and my head, I think we're all going a bit distorted. No, but it's been a great thrill, as you say. You meet personalities, but everybody's equal, and I think you treat everybody the same.
Well, Donald, it's an absolute pleasure to have you on tonight, and with your knowledge and expertise, I'm sure we're going to have a great show.
So stay with us, Donald. Okay, we'll take a break here on Full On Football. When we come back from the break, we'll have Ross Aloisi, the captain of Adelaide United. You're watching Full On Football.
Bianco Building Supplies have been providing quality goods and specialised services to the building industry since 1977. Their staff pride themselves in providing total quality customer service. Whether you require machinery, building supplies, drainage, structural reinforcing steel, or hiring of portable on-site buildings, Bianco's friendly and dedicated staff are only too happy to meet your requirements. And if it's safety products you're after, Bianco Safety have an extensive range to choose from. Their safety van can come direct to you, fit out and supply all your safety needs for your worksite. Visit www.bianco.com.au to have a look at their fantastic range of products. Bianco, number one for all your building and safety supplies.
Hello and welcome back to Full On Football. Well, our next guest is a great friend of mine. He is the Adelaide United captain extraordinaire, Ross Aloisi. Ross, welcome to Full On Football.
Good evening.
How's it going, mate?
Oh, not too bad.
Good stuff. Pre-season training into the fifth week now. How's it been?
Yeah, it's been not too bad. It hasn't been hard at all. Well, the first 3 weeks we eased into it, and we've started weight training as well. So we've got our first double session tomorrow, and it's looking good. A lot of the players have come back pretty fit. And it's not a lot of work to do this year.
Now, because there's such a big break in the between Adelaide United Mark 1 and Mark 2, there was quite a substantial break. I think a couple of the players come back and their skin folds were probably not where they needed to be. How have they been this time? Is Cozzy pretty happy?
Everyone was underweight this year, so the fitness was great. We did some testing before we left, and when we got back, everyone was pretty much up to scratch, and the skin folds were fine.
Ross, good evening.
How are you, Donald?
Good, thanks, Ross. Ross, any new players added to the squad at this point in time?
Not at the moment, no. I'm sure the club are looking at getting a couple in sooner than later. But right this moment in time, we've got hardly anyone there.
After 4 or 5 weeks of pre-season training, as you've done at the moment, how has it been compared to last season?
Well, last year was pretty hard because a lot of players were not as fit as we are this year. We only had 4 weeks off, so we didn't lose too much fitness. But everyone's looking pretty good, and it's a little bit easier out there with training.
Now, Ross, I seen Cozzy a couple of weeks ago, and he mentioned to me that he was giving you a little bit of time off over the World Cup. Do any of the players intend to maybe make the trip to Germany, or is it just a matter of staying here and watching it on the TV and doing your own programs while you've got that time off?
Yeah, I think a few players were trying to get over there, but it was just too hard, so we're just going to hang out here and watch the games on TV and take it from there.
Now, there's talk, Ross, that Chu isn't very happy in China, and could be possibility of him coming back, and also Cozzy's been interested in Stan Lazaridis as well.
Oh, the Chu thing is breaking news, isn't it? I didn't hear that.
So. Oh, yes, we've been meeting up on that.
Well, oh, that'd be great if he could come back. I mean, he was a great player for us last year and brought a lot into our team. And if Stan Lazaridis can come back, that'd be unbelievable for the side.
Well, they were saying that if he hadn't played 50% of the games, which he hasn't as yet, I think he's two games until he plays 50% of all the games, it's a possibility of him like breaking the contract and coming back.
Yeah, that'd be great. Like I said, I guess it's up to the club to hold talks with Stan and see what happens there. But if he could, you know, our left side has always been a bit of trouble because we've always had to play young players on the left-hand side, inexperienced players, and sort of throwing them into the lines then, if you want to call it that, and hope for the best. And Van Dommel and Goulding last season, the first season, did quite well. So, you know, if Stan could come back and play there, would be unbelievable for our team.
What about local players? I mean, I know Cozzy's been out to quite a lot of games. I mean, look, let me throw a name to you, Paul Pezos, a fantastic defender. Now, if he was able to be picked up by Adelaide United, we would give Angelo Costanzo a chance to go back into midfield with you, where he plays very well, actually.
Yeah.
So, and that gives you strength there and a great, strong back line.
Yeah, look, like I said, I'm not in the position to make any decisions like that. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, well, you know, if the club wants to
look at Paul Pezos or any other player, that's good for, gives an incentive to younger players here in the state. But I mean, we've picked up most of our players from the Premier League and now the Super League. And I mean, I guess Jason Spagnolo played in the last finals game that we had in Adelaide and did quite well. So he'd be one that the club would be definitely looking at.
Mm. Ross, do you think it's probably going to come from that second tier of player where you're going to need to get your improvement from in order to take that next step and maybe getting to the grand final? I mean, great season to finish minor Premier, but I mean, the carrot there now is to make the grand final and hopefully bring the big one home, isn't it?
Oh, definitely. I think the second tier players did well, but I wouldn't say it's not that they let us down. It's that some of the older players weren't firing at the right time, and you know, it was a bit unfortunate not to get into the grand final. Even though in Sydney we absolutely smacked Sydney and ended up losing the game, and you know, here we just. It was the second game all season that we hadn't scored a goal, so a bit unfortunate.
Yeah, Ross, just looking at scoring goals, that's probably the most difficult thing any MD can do, of course. And is the club looking at anybody overseas that we could be talking about other than the ones we've just mentioned, but an out-and-out striker?
Yeah, look, I mean, obviously my brother John's been mentioned. Paul Agostino's been mentioned. I think there's a Uruguayan or De Silva or someone that's been mentioned as well. I mean, there's a few. There's a lot of DVDs and videos being sent to the club from various players around the world. And, you know, it's not an easy thing to pick because you can bring a player out and they don't fire for you. And, you know, we had my good mate here, Michael Brooks, the first year, come out halfway through the season and you know, did unbelievably well.
He did.
So, you know, it's always a chance for younger players as well to come through.
I think with Adelaide United just being born a year or two ago, it's given more encouragement for boys in the local competition to think, well, if I step it up and get a little bit better, I could be playing alongside Ross Aloisi or even taking his place one day.
Yeah, well, let's hope that they don't think that. Because I'll have to kick them then, won't I?
But, you do that.
Well, it is. I mean, like I said, John Cosmin has been unbelievable for that. He's been fantastic in picking up players from our local league. So, you know, it's always an incentive for younger players to actually really try and do well. And like I said, Jason Spagnolo, he trained with us, did pre-season, went back to Metros, and we picked him up for the last two games of the season. So, you know, if that's not enough incentive for players here, then I suggest that they give up the game.
Now, Ross, the players have been getting out amongst the community. I mean, we've had players each week visiting Women's and Children's Hospital over there, which is fantastic. We've had players involved in junior development programs. And now you've got this rebate offer where you'll be visiting Campbelltown. You did actually last Friday, didn't you? Yes. And so that gives clubs an opportunity to purchase Adelaide United membership tickets through the club. And the total amount, then the club gets 25% of whatever they've sold. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Right.
And I think it's fantastic that Nick Bianco's done that for the clubs. The clubs can make some money on it. And gets a lot of the kids from the local clubs out to watch our games. We had last Friday night, I was there for 2 hours straight signing autographs, and you know, the amount of kids that were there, and I know kids that actually came from, they weren't training on the Friday night, that made their parents bring them to the club was incredible.
Fantastic.
Yeah, and you know, it's nice for us as well. It got a bit tiring in the end, but you know, it's something that we're not used to here in the state. So I mean, I think that's fantastic that the club is doing that.
And Ross, can you just quickly tell us a little bit about Aurelio Vidmar's testimonial dinner kick coming up?
Yeah, he's got his testimony on Friday, May 26th at Donato Reception Centre, and I think it's $75 a ticket. And, you know, the guy's been fantastic for the game. Aurelio has been, he's had such a great career, and, you know, we can only honour him in a dinner like this. It would be nice to have had a game for him as well, but unfortunately, Aurelio didn't want to do that. But, you know, he's been an ambassador for the game and for the state and for our country. And let's hope that they fill out that reception centre and give him a good sending off.
Exactly right, Ross. Well, Ross, thanks for coming into Full On Football. All the best for the pre-season and the season probably when it gets underway. Lead the team from the front as you normally do, and I'm sure we'll catch up again during the season.
Not a problem, and good luck in the show.
Thanks, Ross.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ross.
That was Ross Aloisi, the captain of the Adelaide United Football Club. We'll take a short break. When we come back, we'll have Carmine Lauriello, the assistant coach of the Campbelltown Red Devils. You're watching Full On Football. Port Road Sports Store. If it's football gear you want, come into Port Road Sports Store, your football specialist store. Official outlet for all Adelaide United merchandise. Stocking football brands like Umbro, Mitre, Lotto, Kelme and Roosh. Come in and see their extensive range of sporting goods and equipment. Port Road Sports Store, 142 Port Road, Hindmarsh, proudly supporting football since 1982.
Welcome back to Full On Football. We now turn our attention to the Super League. And joining us this evening is Carmine Lauriello, the assistant coach of Campbelltown City. Good evening, Carmine.
Good evening to you, Natalie, and the panel.
Michael
and Donald. Yeah, good, thank you.
Carmine, it's been a great start for Campbelltown. You sit atop the table after five rounds, 1-3 and drawn 2. You must be very pleased with the start that your boys have had.
We're exceptionally, we're over the moon at the moment, very pleased. The boys are working very well together, and we're at a point where we can really seriously look at the direction we're going, and that's hopefully to the top.
Now, you yourself and Rocky new to the club, although you have been there before, but this year you're new to Campbelltown.
Correct.
When you got there, what was your goals? You got there and you thought, okay, if we could finish champions, if we could finish somewhere, where was the ideal position that you thought realistically that you'd be challenging?
Well, first of all, we inherited the boys from last year. It was quite a few guys stayed behind, which was a bonus, and it's one of the first years we've had that opportunity, and it certainly makes life a lot easier, and a lot of them were very fit, and so we saw that as a good stepping stone, and we didn't have to waste too much time on pre-season, even though they did put in a good pre-season. And we actually we told them that we want to go to the top, and Rocky stressed that from the beginning. And well, we weren't expecting to be top just yet, but that's what our aim was.
Now, the one thing that's probably stood out to me, Carmine, is the fact that you're probably not a team of champions, and I mean that with all due respect to the players that you got, but at the moment you're playing like a champion team, and sometimes that champion team aspect gets you over the line more than a team of champions.
Well, that is true. We've got a couple of players that are probably well known to supporters. I mean, Elias Demetridis played at a high level, and we've got Alessio Scarsella, who's probably our oldest player in the team, and he's 28, and the rest are all, you know, between 23 and under, and they look like they've been playing for a few years too. So, we've got a good bunch of boys that are pretty willing to work hard.
Carmine, just looking at the Super League, of course, and the lack of goals, I would have to say. I mean, last week there was only 8 goals in 5 games. Mm. In fact, Modbury was the only team that won by 2 clear goals. Are the teams more ultra-defensive nowadays? Because there is a lot of good strikers around, but there is a definite lack of goals.
I don't think that the teams are ultra-defensive, what I've seen. I just think the defenders are better this year. I think a lot of teams have got good structure. I just think it's a lot harder to break down. When you've got good defenders and they're a little bit smarter, it's a lot harder to break those guys down.
I probably think, Donald, with the tightness of the competition, I think most teams or most clubs are going, well, OK, if we can make sure we've got our defensive set up correct to start with, that means we're good for a point before the game's kicked
off.
Yeah,
that's true.
And if you can then try and transgress further up the field to obviously scoring a goal or two, well then you're putting yourself in a pretty good position, Carmine, to get all 3 points, aren't you?
Well, that's your ideal is if you can get a point. If certain things aren't going well, you get a point. But you always look to get the 3. But I haven't seen any teams really sitting back. Probably a couple that may have wanted to hang on to a result, but no, everyone's gone for it.
Well, Carmine, does it surprise you that your own team, Campbelltown City, are actually the top goal scorers in the league at this point in time?
Yeah, we have noticed that, but we've also noticed that we are letting a few goals through. We have addressed that at training, and the good thing about the lads is they take on things quickly, which has been the biggest surprise. We have, every time we mention something, they take things on board really quickly.
Now, as we have a look at last week's round five fixtures, results, we'll see that Campbelltown got a 1-1 draw against Raiders, Carmine. Mm. And can you give us a little bit of a detail as to how that game panned out?
I would have liked to come on the week before when we played Mobbery, but now, all fairness to Raiders, they played very well on the weekend, and I believe it was like highway robbery. We actually just stole a point right at the end. With young Ernie Iccolaro coming on and sneaking in behind the defender, and in no man's land with the keeper, you know, he's not sure whether he's going to get it, and he came out, but he snuck in and got the goal right on the death.
Carmen, how do you keep your enthusiasm for the game? I mean, knowing you as long as I have, of course, and you're still playing in the amateur league, you're assistant to Rocky at Campbelltown, your training must take up two or three nights a week, and then you've got your amateur club as well at Royal Park.
Yeah, I think it's in the blood. You know, that intravenous drip bottle hasn't run out yet. So I don't know. Some people are married to soccer, and I think I might be one of them.
Okay, we might just have a quick look at those results again from round five. Adelaide City nil had a draw with Metro Stars nil. That was on the Friday night at Ram Park. Adelaide Blue Eagles nil were defeated by Adelaide Olympic 1. A great result for Olympic. Defeating the Blue Eagles. Cumberland United nil were defeated by Modbury 2. Jason Trimboli getting a double. Must have been the pep talk that we had on his we had on the show last week with Trimmers coming in. Raiders 1 and Campbelltown 1, as Carmen said, and White City Woodville 1 were defeated by Adelaide Galaxy 2. And as we have a look at the table, we see Campbelltown City right out on top with 11 points, Adelaide City and Galaxy on 9 points, Adelaide Blue Eagles on 7, Metro Stars and Cumberland on 6, Modbury and Olympic on 5, Raiders on 4, and White City Woodville at the foot of the table on 3. If we go to next week's games, Nat, some interesting fixtures there.
Yeah, definitely. Well, you guys, Metro Stars are at home to White City Woodville on Friday night, and also another Friday night game, we've got Modbury at home to Adelaide City. I think that should be a crackerjack game. That one will definitely test out Modbury and see where they are at the moment. The way Adelaide City's been travelling will be a big test for Modbury. Then we have on Saturday, Adelaide Galaxy at home to Adelaide Blue Eagles. Olympic, which actually, that was great that they had a win over the weekend. I was very surprised with that result. And they're up against Raiders at Hanson Reserve. And also Campbelltown at home to Cumberland.
Yeah. And what are you expecting from Cumberland, Carmen?
We've had some interesting games. When I was involved with White City with Cumberland, always difficult to beat. And they're coming off a bit of a bad patch at the moment. But, we're expecting a tough game. They're a hard team to break down. We just like to think that we can do the job on the day, but with Serge, he's always got them well drilled.
I hear an ex-Campbelltown player. Well, he's been at a few clubs, but Sam Monterosso, I heard he has signed for Cumberland.
I believe that, yeah.
So,
I saw his name in the paper.
That'll be one to look out for. Sam on his day, and you never know what you're going to get from Sam, but I suppose he's one that you're going to have to pay some attention to.
Well, yeah, I believe he's going to be a handful, so from all accounts. But I know we're confident with our defenders this year, and hopefully the whole team can, it's not just we don't worry about one player, we've got to worry about the whole.
Yeah, actually, I seen Cumberland last week, Carmen, and they were not that good in the first half. They got a little bit better in the second half, but I did see Sam Monterosso coming on. Mm. He did have a couple of pot shots at goal, and Sam, as we know, is a very, very strong player, and he can score goals, so he will put your defence under a bit of pressure.
Yeah, well, our fellas have been tested with some good players, and they've stood up so far. So.
Well, Carmen, we'd like to thank you for coming on Full On Football.
My pleasure.
Congratulations for Campbelltown's effort so far this season. I hope from my point of view that it doesn't continue. But seriously, it's you've done tremendously well after the first five games, and I'm sure from your point of view, you hope you keep it up.
Thanks for coming in to Full On Football, Carmen. Thank you. Thank you, Nat.
Good dog. Thanks, Carmen.
That was Carmen Lauriello, the assistant coach of the Campbelltown Red Devils, who are having an absolutely magnificent season so far. We'll take a short break. After the break, we'll have Peter Cristarella, the coach of the Enfield City Falcons from the Premier League. You're watching Full On Football.
Bianco Building Supplies have been providing quality goods and specialised services to the building industry since 1977. Their staff pride themselves in providing total quality customer service. Whether you require machinery, building supplies, drainage, structural reinforcing steel, or hiring of portable on-site buildings, Bianco's friendly and dedicated staff are only too happy to meet your requirements. And if it's safety products you're after, Bianco Safety have an extensive range to choose from. Their safety van can come direct to you, fit out and supply all your safety needs for your worksite. Visit www.bianco.com.au to have a look at their fantastic range of products. Bianco, number one for all your building and safety supplies.
Welcome back to Full On Football. Well, our next guest is the coach of the Enfield City Falcons. I'd like to welcome Peter Cristarella. Peter, welcome to Full On Football.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks for having me on.
Not a problem. Peter, after five games, probably a slowish start, but you must be happy with how the boys have picked up in the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, we did. We had a bit of a struggle against Parahills in the first game, since then, we've picked up and got a few things happening quite well.
Now I see Shane Pearce is regularly on the goal scoring sheets for Enfield. He must be pleased for Shane.
Oh, very pleased. He's been exceptional since. The first couple of rounds he didn't score, but I think we started at the Panthers and from there he's gone on from there, and he's quite enjoying his football at the moment.
Yeah. Now, is this your second year in the top job?
Yes.
At Enfield?
Yes.
So how are you finding the second year after establishing yourself in the first year and now senior coach? Sit well with you? A lot of work.
The first year was a big challenge, huge challenge. You know, there's a lot more to the job than people really realise, but yeah, huge. And we had a fairly tough year last year as well. But this year I've sort of settled into it a lot easier than last year, I guess, and it's been good. Really enjoying it at the moment.
Well, Peter, as you know, our cameras were down at your game on Saturday against Croydon, and I thought right from the get-go, Croydon came out and almost scoring within the first minute or so. They were fired up and ready to go.
Yep.
But probably they were like that for about the first 15 to 20 minutes, and
yep,
they had you a bit worried for a while, but then you guys settled down. And I just wrote a few points of what I thought about your team. They had a great strong game, players backing each other up, which was good to see.
Yep.
There was always someone there to back the player up if he was in trouble.
Yep.
Very strong down the right flank with your players down there.
No, yeah, you noticed.
I noticed.
Too many secrets here. No,
he's
one of the best players actually, Luke.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Very strong down there. Strong back line with Jimmy Costa in there.
Yeah.
And he's got an odd shape figure, hasn't he? You sort of look at him, you think, you know, what is he capable of doing?
Surely you're pleased to hear about that, mate.
I mean it kindly. As a player, he's got a very strange figure, but he's very, very strong, very stocky, and he is very strong in that
back
line.
He's strong, and he's very quick. He's very deceiving.
Very deceiving.
Very deceiving.
Also, one touch in front of goals, no hesitation to shoot far out from goals, not trying to get the extra step or the extra touch in. And good direct passing.
That's fantastic. I need to get you down to our training sessions, I reckon, Nat.
Yeah. Well, that's what I know. Because
assistant coach now.
Yeah,
No. This was just purely watching
good.
The game. I think that's where you had the upper hand on Croydon. They were forced into making a lot of errors, and you were able to overturn the game many, many, many times.
We did struggle that the first 15. I agree. We were really under the hammer. They came out. They were on fire.
Mm.
And had those opportunities gone in, that would have could have gone anywhere. But we regrouped. We made a couple of subtle changes as well, and things worked out really well in the end.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Now, Peter, Enfield and Croydon have probably had some real ding-dong battles over the years with promotion to and from the State League to the Premier League. This game obviously sounds like it was much of the same. You must have been really happy to eventually come out with the 2-1 winners.
Yeah, huge, Michael. We know every time we go to Croydon, it's going to be it's going to be a real battle. And with Joe down there as well, he's got his. I've seen him play a couple of times, and I thought they're a very good team. a very good squad. And I guess we had our concerns, but like Nat said, the players backed each other up, and they're quite enjoying their soccer at the moment as well. And just
while we're on the Croydon and Enfield game, we might just go to those interviews, Nat, with Jimmy Costa of the Enfield City Falcons and Joe Lagana, the captain of the Croydon Kings.
Talking to Jim Costa from Enfield City, what a great win that was.
Yeah, that was a good game there by the boys. We dug in deep, especially second half. First half we had the win, and I like to go 1-0 down with a lucky goal, but I thought the boys fought back well, and we just stuck in their second half, especially with the win coming our way.
You definitely got a lot of backup there. Players are really backing each other up as opposed to Croydon. So how do you sort of go about setting guys up like that? Because they really played well today.
Yeah, I think it's more if you've got the backbone of the team. Sort of me and Mark Graham have been playing for a while, I suppose. Then you've got the likes of Joe Stone in the middle, been playing for a while as well, I suppose. And you've got PC up front. So as long as we got the players around us, we look pretty good.
Yeah,
so.
Well, you're very, very strong in the back there, and that was definitely the telling tale there. You've been beaten by Parahills. Yep. You're going very well, actually. Is this more to your liking in this league, in the Premier League?
I think it's good to, I suppose, to get the youngsters coming up, sort of, you know, just give them a chance at playing Premier League and sort of give them a bit more experience. So when the chance does come, if we happen to go up, then that gives them sort of a backbone start to play and good opportunity to keep going. So, yeah.
Well, you've got Nordlanger at home next week.
Yeah, well, Nordlanger should be a tough game. I'm not sure what the results were today, but we always know that Nordlanger are always a hard team. They always fought to the end. So, I mean, it's going to be another... There's no easy game this year, so it's going to be another hard game.
Mm. Well, that was a great win by you guys, and a great game by yourself personally.
Thank you.
All the best for next week, and thanks for talking to Full On Football.
Thanks for that. Cheers. Can I just take an opportunity just to thank a sponsor?
Sure.
Regency Building Supplies. They're on 76 Days Road. Just to all the boys, Angelo, Johnny and Peter. If you need any quotes or truss quotes, just head down our way, just over the road here. So, yeah,
thank you.
Thanks.
No worries. Okay, we're now speaking to Joe Lagana from Croydon Kings. Joe, would I be right in saying that was a disappointing game for you guys?
Yeah, very disappointing. I think we created enough chances in the first half to, we hit the bar a few times, but then we sort of let them in. We gave them a cheap goal, we gave them a cheap second goal, you know, with a deflection. You know, and then they hit the bar as well. So, I mean, it was a tough game, tough struggle, but, you know, very disappointing to lose the points.
Do you think that your two games against Playford might be a telling factor as to why you played this way today, or don't you think that comes into it at all?
It was three games in 8 days last week and then another one this week. I mean, we trained pretty light during the week to try and freshen up, but, yeah, it's also, you know, mental toughness as well because we fired up to play Playford because we got beaten in the cup, so you know, we sort of let them in this game, and it's probably our detriment as well, you know, more than anything.
It looked like there wasn't a lot of backup between players today.
Yeah, I don't know why it wasn't happening. I think just maybe the cheap goal sort of just brought the feeling down between us, and you know, we've got to be stronger than that. If we're going to do anything in this league, if we're going to win anything, we've got to be a lot stronger. So we can't let games like this or, you know, an effort like that get the better of us.
Well, definitely, so. Because it's first past the post this year, you can't afford to give away
that's
games
exactly
like
right.
that, can
well,
you?
It's a 6 points now break on Parahills that they've got on the rest. It's 3 points here to these guys, and you know, there's no finals. It's just first past the post, straight in.
Yeah, well, you've got Northern Demons going up to Piri next week, so that'll be a tough trip for you guys.
It's always a tough trip up there. They, you know, they're a decent squad. They always pull together and they play hard, and you know, we're expecting nothing but another tough game. So every week it's going to be a tough game, and we've just got to be mentally right for each game.
Well, you personally, you had a great game today. Very, very strong in the back there, along with is it Panna with you?
Yeah, Georgie Panna.
Yeah,
he's been pretty good for us this year.
You both were extremely hard today. So
it's disappointing we didn't get the points.
Yeah, definitely.
So.
Well, look, all I can say is good luck for next week,
no
and
worries.
Thank you very much for speaking to
Thanks.
Us today.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Okay.
Yes, and there we heard, actually, a very dejected Joe Lagana, who was very disappointed with the game, and rightly so, because I imagine they would have expected a win there at home.
Yeah, Peter, just going back to that game, of course. I've seen you playing 2 or 3 weeks ago in the cup game against the Cobblers. Very entertaining game. You got 2-0 2-0 up at the one stage with about 10 or so minutes to go. You made a couple of changes, but backfires, as coaches do. Do you learn very much from those sort of things? Because you put on a couple of very, very young players.
Yep. Well, I guess the objective that day was obviously to get a win. We're always out to play, you know, you're playing to get a win. But we also, it was an opportunity also to try a couple of the French players that haven't had much of a run. So it was an opportunity to do that as well. And I guess it backfired on the day, but. There's always good that comes out of things as well, and that I guess it highlighted a few areas that we need to concentrate on.
You must have been absolutely delighted beating Croydon, because just a few days earlier Croydon had beaten Playford. Yeah. I mean, and Playford was sitting high at the top of the league, playing good football, and all of a sudden Croydon thumped them because they thumped Croydon in the cup at once.
They did
4-1. Yeah. So you must have been particularly delighted with that result last week.
That was it was fantastic, really. And to get to be under the hammer so early in the game, and then come back and score those two goals in the first half, and then hang on to them right through the second half. That was it was good signs anyway.
Great effort.
Peter, looking into the rest of the season, it must be pleasing from your point of view as a senior coach down there to know that you've only just fallen just below the line against Parahills. You've beaten Playford and Croydon. Those teams around you, you must have a lot of confidence that you're just about right on the mark, aren't you?
Well, yeah, at this stage, I know it's early days, it's only 5 rounds.
That's
but,
right.
Yeah, it's, I mean, the it feels good and the signs are looking good. And, you know, Shane Pearce has scored 6. He's up there with a couple others on 7. Mm. So he's enjoying his stay at the moment as well. So
and just on the goal scorers, we might just have a look at the round 5 results for the best bricks and pavers Premier League results.
Yes, shall we do that? We had Adelaide Hills defeating Northern Demons 2-1 with Burgess and Elliott scoring the goals for Hills and Pavanello for Northern Demons. Croydon obviously being defeated by your good selves 2-1 with Akira scoring for Croydon and Pearson to Sony for Enfield. Norlunga United 2, Playford 3 with Edwards for Playford scoring 2 there and Smith. And Parahills defeating Panthers 3-0. So Parahills are just so strong, it's unbelievable. Tobias Milady and McDermott again, and I like that player McDermott. Tall player comes on, always, basically nearly always gets a goal. A bit like when you were with Adelaide United,
Vogel. I think he's won 2 under-23 player of the year as well.
He's a great player.
And Milady, I think he's won twice the State League player of the year. So.
Well, Milady is a great player, but this new guy, McDermott, I do like the style of game he plays. And then last but not least, we had Pirates defeating Salisbury 4-2. With yet another hat-trick in the Premier League, Aloisi scoring 3, which puts him atop of the goal-scoring list on 7 goals.
And Donald, if we have a look at the ladder, Parahills out on top, played 5, won 5 on 15 points.
Yeah, I'm not surprised Parahills are on top, Michael. I think they've recruited very well, but just looking at the league, you can see that it's going to be difficult for them, of course, with Playford, Denfield, Croydon. And we tend to forget the team, even at the bottom of the league, they've had a horrendous start. Panthers, if you look at names on paper, they don't play on fields, of course, but names on paper, that team, if they get a run, they could be up there with the best of them. So I would imagine it's going to be a tight competition, and people have said to me, and many games can a team in that league afford to lose? I think if you lose any more than 2 games, I think you're in big trouble. What do you think, Peter?
Yes, with the finals being taken out of the equation, it's a final. Basically, it's finals every week. We need to, and I think we're all aware of that. We need to go out and try and secure at least one, if not the 3 points, every week.
And we'll have a look at next week's round 6 fixtures. Parahills are at home to the Adelaide Hills. Pirates are home to the Panthers. Playford City are taking on Salisbury at Ramsay Park in the Northern Derby, which been fiery clashes in the past. Northern Demons are at home at Burn Park to Croydon, and your team, Peter, Enfield take on Norlunga. What do you expect from Norlunga?
I expect a very hard game.
And that is Saturday night at Rushworth.
It's at night,
Reserve,
yeah. Yeah, night game. Yeah,
7:30. So it should be a toughie.
It will be. I did see a little bit of Norlunga against Croydon, and yeah, it's going to be another battle.
You'll have to keep your eye out for a hybrid. So he appears to be appearing quite regularly on the score sheet as well, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does, and you will be watching out for him, I'm sure.
Just on that, Michael, of course, if you look at the record of Nelligan, there's 23 goals being scored in their five games so far. They've scored 13, but the deficit is 10. But it's obviously a team that's entertaining one way or the other.
Yep, they definitely are. They'll be a handful. And I guess with this new setup, every game we've had so far has been a tough game. So, we expect it to
and
be just as tough.
Imagine it will continue all the way through the season.
Definitely.
Peter, all the best on your bid for the promotion to the Super League. Thanks for coming in to share your time, and we wish you all the best. Thanks for coming in to Full On Football.
Thank you, Michael, Donald, Nat.
Thanks very much.
That was Peter Cristarella, the coach of the Enfield City Falcons. When we come back after the break, we'll have Shaun Claridge, the White City Woodville U23 player. We're talking the U23 and 19 Super League results. You're watching Full On Football.
Do you want to be a part of Full On Football? We are always looking for businesses and organisations to join us in bringing all the local football news to our viewers. So if you'd like to assist us with financial sponsorship or provide goods or services for our competitions and special segments, contact us on 0421 507 948 or send us an email to adamna@optusnet.com.au. We'd love to have you on board.
Hello and welcome back to Full On Football. Well, our next guest is a White City Woodville U23 player, Shaun Claridge. Shaun, welcome to Full On Football.
Thanks for having me on the show.
Not a problem. Season so far, how's it been going?
Yeah, it's been going good. We've hit some good form, scoring 7 goals in the last 2 games and only conceding 1. And obviously we've won both of them and we're playing really well.
Yeah. And the position that you play for the viewers that don't know about Shaun Claridge, give us a little bit of history about you.
I used to play in the middle because I'm sort of a workaholic and run a lot. But now, because of me running, I've been put on the right wing, so I have to get up there for the attacks and back for the defence and then back up there and back down. And yeah.
Do a lot of the legwork.
Yeah, most of the legwork.
Now, Shaun, you actually played with the seniors in pre-season. Tell us about how you enjoyed that.
Yeah, that was really good. With Chris coming in, he's a really good coach, and I got picked up from the State 18 boys last year. And yeah, it was a really good experience. There's a good bunch of guys there and a lot of experience and stuff, and it's just a good learning experience, and I've learned a lot so far.
So when you play with older players like that, are they able to help you along, if you do make a mistake or you make an error of judgment or something, are they there straight away to help you?
Yeah, they are. Yeah, they help a lot, and like I said, I've only been at White City for a few months now, but I've learned a lot already. Yeah,
Shaun, that's what I was going to ask you. Where have you come from? Because I've watched White City for a number of years, watching the juniors, the 19s, the 23s. I haven't seen you, but obviously you've must have made a bit of an impact in playing already in the first team.
Yeah, last year I was at Cumberland and I was with the first team squad then. And then I was back down and played most of the season 23s, but then I was picked up by the state team and I was in the state 18s last year. And then that's when Chris and a few other blokes came out and they picked me up from there. And yeah, so with them now. Yeah.
Now we'll have a look at the Super League Under-23's results for Round 5.
We will, because the Under-23's, as I say, have been waiting for their turn to be reported on, and here we go. Adelaide City defeated Metro Stars 2-1. Blue Eagles and Olympic had a draw, 1-1. Cumberland were defeated by Modbury 2-0. And Campbelltown also defeated Raiders 2-0, and White City defeated Galaxy 4-0. That was a great win there for you.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
Was the 4-0 result that convincing? Should it have been more, or were you perhaps a little bit lucky to perhaps stick 4 past the Galaxy?
No, I think we actually deserved more. We played really, really well, and like I said, we've hit some really good form, and I believe that it should have been more than 4.
And we see on the table net the Adelaide City in the Under-23 Super League are out on top with 12 points, followed by White City on 10. Then we have SASI, Modbury and Campbelltown all on 9 points, Blue Eagles on 8, Metro Stars on 7, Raiders 6, Olympic 4, Galaxy 2 and Cumberland 1.
Yeah, shall we also look at the Under-19 scores as well, because we haven't been able to update where they are at the moment. So results for round 5 for Under-19s were
Metro Stars defeating Adelaide City 1-0. Adelaide Blue Eagles defeating Adelaide Olympic 3-0. Comprehensive win there. Modbury defeating Cumberland 2-0. Campbelltown defeating Raiders 3-1. And again, White City defeating a Galaxy 4-0.
Sean, it appears to be a lot of pressure coming from the 19s and the 23s onto the first team players. Does Chris Trajanowski, the senior coach, is he there for the 19s and 23s? Is he monitoring how the progression of the young boys are coming along at White City?
Yeah, I think he is. Yeah, he does get out as often as he can, and I do believe that he's there keeping an eye on everyone.
And what's your goals for the rest of the season?
I just aim to get back in the first team, get up there and start training with them again, and hopefully get in the first 11 and play some good games.
So do you, during the week, do you train with the senior team, or are you predominantly training with the 23s, and then if you get called up, then you're able to make the transition?
No, at the moment I'm just down with the 23s and just trying to get a bit more fitness and work on some little things I need to change in my game, and yeah, once I do that, then you know, I think I'll be back up there.
I just thought, Michael, that we'd also look at the table for the under 19s so we don't miss them out. We've got Cumberland sitting on top on 13. White City Woodville again in second position there on 12 points along with Metro Stars. Adelaide Blue Eagles on 9. Adelaide City and Adelaide Galaxy on 7. Modbury on 5. Raiders on 3. Adelaide Olympic on 2. And Cumberland on 1. I just wanted to ask you one question, Sean. There's been a lot of talk that under 19s and under 23 should be scrapped and we go back to the reserves like we did many years ago. What's your thoughts on that?
I actually like the 19s and 23s because if you actually look at it, it's meant to be like, 23s is meant to be actually, you know, reserves for the first team, which it is. And our squad, if you look at it, like names on, you know, the paper or actually come out and watch us play, it is basically a reserve team. So I think just keeping it the way it is, you know, is good. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just quickly, Donald?
Yeah, Sean, just what Nat said, of course, wouldn't you prefer to play against the older, more experienced players because they give you a lot more experience, you know how to avoid tackles, you know how to put in tackles?
Yeah, playing against older, more experienced players is a lot better, I believe, because, like you said, you know, you learn a lot more things and you know, you can improve your game dramatically.
Well, Sean, thanks for coming in to Full On Football and giving us your time. All the best for the rest of the season. I dare say I'll probably see you at TK Shuttle on Friday night, seeing White City playing Metro.
Yep.
Come up and say hello. All the best for the rest of the season, and hopefully we'll see you back on the show in the near future, playing in the first team on a regular basis.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for coming in, Sean.
Thanks for having me.
That was Sean Claridge from White City Woodville, a young player trying to make his way up into the first team. You're watching Full On Football.
Bianco Building Supplies have been providing quality goods and specialised services to the building industry since 1977. Their staff pride themselves in providing total quality customer service. Whether you require machinery, building supplies, drainage, structural or reinforcing steel, or hiring of portable on-site buildings, Bianco's friendly and dedicated staff are only too happy to meet your requirements. And if it's safety products you're after, Bianco Safety have an extensive range to choose from. Their safety van can come direct to you, fit out and supply all your safety needs for your worksite. Visit www.bianco.com.au to have a look at their fantastic range of products. Bianco, number one for all your building and safety supplies.
Welcome back to Full On Football. It's now time to look at the State League, and shall we go straight into the results, Michael?
Yes, we shall.
Okay, Matt? Let's have a look at the results from round 5 for State League. And should I say, it's the best bricks and pavers, 2006 State League. We had Adelaide Cobras 4, NAB 0, with Concaratevla scoring 2 there in Sicalis. And
Seaford 3, Gawler 3, so a high-scoring game there. Pei, Powell and Lewandowski for Seaford and Sinclair, two for Gawler, with Truscott scoring the other one.
And we had Western Strikers 6, trouncing Adelaide Comets 1. Now, that is an enormous result there, because they were very close matchups there.
And Adelaide Comets were actually 1-0 up at half-time.
Definitely. That's unbelievable.
Charlie Villani must have had some stern words to the Striker boys at half-time, that's for sure.
And we had McNeil, Amalia and Krawczynski all on 2 from Western Strikers, and Zentidis from Adelaide Comets scoring the lonely goal there. And
Port Pirie 2, Western Districts Toros 1. Savoni for the Toros and McGuinness for Port Pirie City. If we have a look at the table in the State League, Adelaide Cobras way out on top on 15 points with the Strikers on 12, so it looks like it's going to come down to those two. I think it was actually 1 versus 3 last week and 2 versus 4, so you can just see the gulf between the top two and the rest of the competition. NAB on 8 points, Adelaide Comets on 7, Gawler and Port Pirie on 4, Seaford on 3 and Western Districts Toros on 2.
And Toros seem to be struggling a little of late.
Yes, they certainly are. Yes. And if we have a look at next week's round, Donald, if you could run through those for us.
And yes. Could you give us a prediction as well?
Well, of course, the one that kicks off is Adelaide Comets against Seaford. And, of course, Seaford haven't won a game for about approximately 2 years. But they must be promising because they've scored 10 goals so far this year. So they must be on the verge of getting a victory. But I don't think they'll get it against the Comets. I'll go over the Comets on that one.
And just to note that that is at Santos Stadium, where Comets are playing their home games.
Yeah, that's the first game. I think they're making a big issue of it, and good luck to them, you know. So well done to the Comets. NAB will face up to Western Strikers at the Athelstan Recreation Reserve. NAB against Strikers. Well, I think we'd have to go with Charlie Villani's team after that resounding victory last week, Michael.
Certainly will do. I think Strikers should be too strong for NAB.
An interesting one. Western District Toros versus the league leaders, Cobras. I would have to go along with the Cobras and that one, 5 wins.
Yeah, I can't see Toros causing any problems for Cobras at this stage.
Cobras are taking all before them, aren't they?
Mm. Yeah, and finally, Michael, Gawler versus Port Pirie City up at Gawler, and that'll be an interesting one. But can Gawler get a victory there? I think they've got one victory, but can they make it 2?
Well, Port Pirie City aren't travelling too well, Donald, so I'd probably favour maybe Gawler maybe just.
Yeah, I would too at home. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so nothing much between them. Both of them had one victory, and both of them will be looking for the second.
Yeah, they sure would be.
Okay, Nat, that's it for our Best Bricks and Pavers 2006 State League Round 6 results. We'll take a short break. When we come back, we'll have Volunteer of the Month. You're watching Full On Football.
Marco Polo Foods SA are importers and wholesalers of gourmet and continental products. They are the sole distributors of the famous Radenska iced teas, free from preservatives and caffeine, and stock all Podravka products, specialising in Vegeta gourmet stocks, spreads and soups. Marco Polo Foods is a family-run business which pride themselves with a large variety of imported and local products that are stocked at leading stores such as Drake Foodland, Woolworths, Gourmet Butchers, selected IGA stores and Continental stores. Drop in and see Adam or Corinne Tronconi at 438 Torrens Road, Kilkenny, or ring them on 8345 3792. Marco Polo, fine foods from across the sea.
Welcome back to the show. Now it's time for this is one of my favourite segments, actually. It's the Volunteer of the Month segment. Now, we've been asking you over the last couple of weeks to nominate a volunteer from your club. This is a great opportunity for all clubs to nominate someone that works within the club, a volunteer that works either on game day or perhaps during trainings or just generally around the club. And we want you to recognise the work that they do. So what we're asking you to do is send in their name and give us a little bit of a description about what they do at the club, or perhaps how long they've been there and what significance it is, and send it in to Volunteer of the Month, ADAMNA at optusnet.com.au. And let me tell you guys, we have had some people sending in some great worthy nominations. Let me tell you, it's going to be very interesting reading some of them out and letting people know about some of the fantastic volunteers that are out there in the clubs around South Australia. Now, the first winner will be announced in the first week of June, so you've still got a couple of weeks to go. please send them in. Acknowledge the people that work within your club, and we've got a lovely prize of a $50 voucher from Marco Polo Foods. Adam Tronconi down there at Torrens Road, Kilkenny, has kindly donated that for us. So get them in while you can, and we'll be looking forward to naming that Volunteer of the Month in a couple of weeks.
When we come back from the break, we'll have Shaun's brother, Shannon Claridge, from the Western Strikers under 13 Division 8. You're watching Full On Football. Port Road Sports Store. If it's football gear you want, come into Port Road Sports Store, your football specialist store. Official outlet for all Adelaide United merchandise. Stocking football brands like Umbro, Mitre, Lotto, Kelme and Roosh. Come in and see their extensive range of sporting goods and equipment. Port Road Sports Store, 142 Port Road Hindmarsh, proudly supporting football since 1982.
Welcome back to Full On Football. It's time now for our Junior League segment, and we've got a great special guest in tonight, and we're going to be looking at the under-13s divisions. And we have Shannon Claridge with us, who's an under-13 centre midfielder for Western Strikers and has also been named in the under-13 state team that's going to be going to Sydney in July for the Nationals. Welcome to the show, Shannon.
Thanks.
Thanks very much for coming along.
Thank you.
How are you enjoying it at Western Strikers? Because I know you've just left Adelaide Olympic. You were there with us last year and you've gone to Western Strikers. How have you found that?
Yeah, well, Olympic and Western Strikers are both great clubs and they've both got great coaches. And at Western Strikers got the zone coach for the last two years, Richard Preston. He's a great coach and I've already learnt a lot of him.
Well, he used to play for West Adelaide, so he's a great player there to have as a coach, actually.
Now, Shannon, you play in the centre midfield, so you got the Chelsea shirt on tonight in the studio. Who's your favourite player?
Probably Frank Lampard.
And have you tried to model your game on Frank Lampard, or are you just trying to bring your own unique style to the game?
Yeah, probably just my own unique style, just playing however the game goes.
Now, centre midfield, are you a defending midfielder or do you like to get forward and get on the score sheet and do the world celebrations as well?
Well, I can play either, you know, attacking or defensive. I think I'm strong in both. I like playing defensive more than attacking, though. So.
Yeah, Shannon, I'm led to believe you're also an excellent cricketer with a real future in front of you. I mean, if you look at the former Australian captain, Steve Waugh, he was a footballer of extraordinary talent, of course, and he went up to the state under-18s. When will you decide what your career will be? Will it be a footballer or will it be a cricketer?
Well, I'm still young, so I think it might obviously be a couple more years till I decide and just see which sport I progress more in. So, yes.
Now, Shannon, I've seen your eyes light up when Ross Aloisi entered the room before. Have you maybe got a burning ambition at the back of your mind to perhaps play for Adelaide United one day? Would you love to do that?
Yeah, I'd like to do that. We'll play at any professional level. Would be great.
I have to tell you that I obviously Shannon played in the same team as my daughter Lucy did last year and the year before. And look, he's a very, very strong, commanding player and he makes his presence known on that pitch. You know, he's a very integral part of the team and a fantastic chap to boot. Brilliant with his heading skills, absolutely strong in that department. And, you know, you're telling a fib, you really do like scoring those goals, don't you?
Yes.
We had a cup final, a cup game the other week, last week, against his old team Olympic. Dying stages of the game, who do you think scored the goal to win?
Shannon popped up, did he?
Shannon did. So well done, mate. That was a great game.
And Shannon, I'm led to believe you've been selected to play for the state under-13s in Sydney next month. How high do you see that in your career so far? Very young, of course.
Yeah, well, I think that's a great achievement. And I suppose I've earned my position in the team and hopefully I'd be able to continue in the team.
I see you've got a knack of scoring goals, of course. Who do you take that from, Brooksy?
I don't know.
Who locally do you like as a player? Who do you, not model, but which one of the players locally do you like?
I don't know, really. myself.
Yourself. Oh, well done. I love a guy who's got great confidence, and that you have, Shannon, definitely have. Look, why don't we take our time now to have a look at the all the different ladders in the A, B and C divisions of the under-13s. Let's look at the A division first. We can see Campbelltown on top with 12 points. Western Strikers, your team, on 10, and you are a very, very strong team, may I add. Para Hills and Modbury on 9, Adelaide City on 7, Adelaide Olympic on 6, Panthers and Cumberland on 3, and Norlunga, Burkalla and Mount Barker yet to get some points up on the board there. Under 13B, Michael, would you like to
The Manapara are on top there with 12 points, played 4-1 for 27 goals, 4 and 13 against. So obviously a very attacking team on 12 points. Para Hills on 9, Playford, Blue Eagles and Campbelltown on 6, the Comets and Western Strikers on 4, Panthers on 3, and the Torres and Adelaide Hills are on 0.
Donald, would you like to read out the under-13s?
You got them in front of us?
Yeah, sure. Here we are. Yeah, Donald.
On top, after 4 games, we see Metro Stars on top with a maximum of 12 points. The only team to do that so far. Gawler have 9 points, Pirates have 6, as does Comets and Croydon. Raiders also have 6, 4 teams in fact. Well done. Adelaide Hills on 3, Cobras on 3, Seaford on 3, Adelaide Olympic on 3, and Plimpton down at the bottom
and
with
you
no
would,
point.
And you would, sorry for cutting in there, Donald, you would notice that some of these teams have not played 4 games yet because of the break that we had for the Easter. And
we spoke about that last week,
yes, we did, so yes. They're still to have some catch-up games. Let's have a look at who these people have got for the next round 6 this weekend. Adelaide Olympic, this is the division 13A division. Adelaide Olympic are home to Cumberland. Mount Barker are home to Western Strikers. How do you see that game panning out, Shannon?
Well, it'll be a tough game like every game because on the day any team can win. I think we just got to play as we normally do, just pass the ball around and hopefully score some goals and win.
And let me tell you, Mount Barker there is a very tough and physical team. Mm. So that
need
should
to
be
on your game
one.
This week, Shannon.
Yep. Definitely.
You reckon you can beat them?
Hopefully.
You got a prediction?
Hopefully about 5 or something nil.
5-0?
Yeah. I don't think they've got a point yet.
Shannon, you said Richard Preston's your coach now. As Michael knows, Richard was a very good player in the National Soccer League. But the senior coach of the club is Charlie Bellani. He's an ex-Australian international. Do you look up to people like that with the respect they deserve?
I didn't really know the senior coach. I think most of us probably would like people that played at Western Strikers last year might know more about him and that. So.
Yeah, okay. Being new to the club, you may not know.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go back to the fixtures for the 13As. We have got Modbury at home to Campbelltown, Para Hills at home to Norlunga, and South Adelaide at home to Burkalla.
In the under-13B division, fixtures for round 6, the 14th of May, Campbelltown are at home to Adelaide Comets, Blue Eagles are at home to Para Hills, White City Woodville take on Playford, Western Strikers are at home to Manapara, and Western Districts versus the Adelaide Hills and South Adelaide Panthers have the bye.
And Donald, 13Cs?
Yes, Cobras are home to Croydon, Comets are home to Adelaide Olympics, Seaford versus Raiders, Plimpton versus Adelaide Hills, Gawler versus Port Lyon, and the bye goes to Metro Stars. And I must say, I've seen the kids down at Plimpton Oval, I live in that area, and the enthusiasm generated there is fantastic. Mm.
They're great, yeah, the kids do play good football.
So do the juniors still play out of like where the seniors play, at Royal Park?
What team are you talking about? Western Strikers are at Carnegie Reserve.
Carnegie Reserve, yes.
That's Royal Park.
Royal Park,
yes, sure it is.
Well, Shannon, big thank you for coming into Full On Football. Obviously, you use a lot of confidence, and we've seen him before, Nat. We came on air doing his hair in the.
This is a person that you're going to hear, if he sticks to this football, you will definitely hear a lot more about him, let me tell you.
Do you think he looks a bit like Shane Warne?
No, he's better looking than that, my goodness.
Shannon, all the best for the future, whether it be football, we hope it's football, but if you decide to take up a career in cricket, all the best for whichever code you choose. Hopefully it's football, and you never know, we might see you playing in an Adelaide United strip one day.
And good luck with the Nationals next month in July.
Yeah, thanks. All the best. Thanks.
All the best, Shannon.
That was Shannon Claridge from the Western Strikers Under-13 Division A. When we come back, we'll have Chichi May, the SASI player. You're watching Full On Football. Port Road Sports Store. If it's football gear you want, come into Port Road Sports Store, your football specialist store, official outlet for all Adelaide United merchandise, stocking football brands like Umbro, Mitre, Lotto, Kelme and Roosh. Come in and see their extensive range of sporting goods and equipment. Port Road Sports Store, 142 Port Road, Hindmarsh, proudly supporting football since 1982. Welcome back to Full On Football. Well, it's now my pleasure to introduce SASI player Chichi May. Chichi, welcome to Full On Football.
Thank you. Great to be here.
How's the season been going for you guys?
Season's been going well. Just on a piece of paper, I think the result doesn't really show how we've been working as a team. I guess it's, you know, I think more this year we're more focused on going forward rather than being so defensive. And just a matter of us finishing and not letting the guys run through, because once they're off, they're going because they're so fast. So, yeah, playing in a boys' league is really challenging, and that's good for us though.
Do you enjoy playing in the boys' league?
Or I love it.
Yeah?
Yeah, I love it. I think the team really likes it. It's just, it really puts pressure on. So later in the year when we work towards National League, we can be ready to be under the pump straight away. Yep. And deal with that pressure a lot better.
Chichi, you've been playing football for such a long time. I remember when you were only 13 or 14, your mum driving you
around.
Everyone
was scared of me because I was like the only one that had developed before then, like, you know. But yeah, my mum is always around, and now she's the manager, and yeah, she's probably more involved than I am sometimes. So.
What position are you playing nowadays? Because you seem to be pretty versatile a number of years ago.
Yeah, I have been playing, I play all along the back line. Mm-hmm. We play with a flat four now, so but generally on the right because I'm right footed. Sometimes if needed I go into the midfield, but not very often. So, but this year, yeah, normally in defence, but I'm injured at the moment, so...
That's okay. Sorry, Donald. Chichi, when you are playing, are you a quite assuming right fullback, or are you one of those in your face, gritty, knock them down at all costs type?
No, we've definitely got
to play. Because I've come across a few of those in my time, and you look like one of those players.
I think when I was younger, I was a lot more aggressive. We do have a girl on our team, but we you know, she's our very aggressive player. Watch out. You don't want her against you, but it's great for us.
So you're mellowing with AJ?
Maybe. No. More so, I'm a better player at slowing someone down I guess experience gives me that. I try and use that rather than having to work on me chasing someone, because I know that maybe isn't my best asset.
Chichi, is it toughened you up playing in the boys' league?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, for sure.
Would you encourage other young girls younger than yourself to do that?
I think it's always great to play with the boys because it's a different game. But I do encourage girls to play with girls as well, because I'm not playing club at the moment, and it is different, you know, when you're playing in girls, because in our under 16 boys league, I mean, some of the players are very talented, but sometimes it can be a very kick and run kind of game. And I think the girls try and play it around a little bit more.
So what age would you encourage the girls to maybe stick with an all girls competition until a certain age, and then maybe make the transition to the boys comp, or would you encourage them maybe to branch out early on?
I think while you're younger, you can play in boys teams and things like that, but it's great to develop with girls, and it also will, the more girls we have trying to play together, the better women's football is going to be, I think. Like, because it will just, you know, enlarge the whole popularity of it, so.
Now, a couple of weeks ago, we had the boys on, Rob Pepicelli and Michael Brooks, asking the question. I wasn't able to answer
you're
this.
You're going to get so me into trouble here,
yes,
aren't
you? Yes, I am. This is going to come straight from the person that plays in this league.
Oops.
They were asking whether, as players, do boys tend to hold back when they're coming in up against you, or do they go in hard when they're playing?
Yeah, but that wasn't meant as a derogatory question, Chichi, because it's a natural thing to ask, because there's obviously physicalities differences
definitely.
There. So
there's a funny question, because the people that go in hard against us would more be the parents, because we don't care that we're playing guys.
Yeah.
And obviously, it seems pretty good. Like, I guess in previous years, we've always had like our rival teams and the boys. We know the boys that we're playing against. But this year around, it seems, you know, the guys are going in hard as well. The thing is, they tend to say sorry afterwards, where I don't know if we would say sorry because, you know, we're doing the same. It's like if it's a 50-50 ball, the girls are in there. And if a guy wants to take out one of our players, I'm sure that one girl would want to take him out too. So it's, yeah, it's the
fair
same.
Enough.
Like, they have to go in hard. I think they got to play the game how it is. And yeah. Yeah.
It's a well-known fact that women's football doesn't get enough coverage.
Definitely
of what
not.
It is. But
yeah.
Of course, next month you get the Asian Cup and you're going to see this national teams from nine countries coming.
Yes.
What will that mean to women's football here in South Australia?
I think it's a really good opportunity. I think we need to definitely get out there and promote it. We have like one of our, we have one girl that's in the squad at the moment, but obviously the team won't be announced until further on. But we do need to really promote it because South Australia never gets enough crowds for women's football, and I think this is a really good move for us to have it here, just to be able to see where you can be if you work really hard. So.
And Chi-Chi, any ambitions to play with the, is it the Adelaide Sensation?
I've been with the Sensation squad since 99. So.
Okay, so your season ends when theirs picks up, so you're almost playing all year round, are you?
Yeah, normally we have a home and away season, just like the guys do.
Yep.
But last year we played a 10-day tournament, which is the most tiring thing
done.
They
compressed the 14-week season.
It was most definitely different.
So the National League season was only for like 10 days.
Yes. Yeah, and we were put into groups and played. I think it was like you played a game, you ate food, you slept, you played.
And what Chi-Chi was saying to me today over the phone was that in that situation there, they weren't able to play home and away, so they weren't able to play in front of their own crowds, they weren't able to have that sort of, you know, advantages. And it was just way too tiring, just way too strenuous on a body to be able to...
The only advantage was that you did have the ability to watch other teams and see where everyone's at and just, like, obviously see who you're up against, but also watch experienced players.
Did you have a big squad or was it just a 16-lady squad?
I think we took about 18 people away. So some days some girls wouldn't get a game at all. But we definitely needed those players that were not starting to be there, be fresh, ready to go. So
what's the forecast for the league season this year?
There's been lots of talk. It's a matter of, obviously money's always an issue. If we're flying every weekend, it's a lot more money than if we go away for a 10-day tournament. But I know a lot of the girls that I've spoken to have said we'd definitely rather have home and away games because then we can recover from games. And, you know, you're feeling 100% when you start the next game rather than, you know, being that little bit tired because every week, every game gets, you know, you get more tired. And but then again, it could be another 10-day tournament. They're not really sure and I don't think they'll focus on that.
So could you let the viewers know, obviously with the men and they've got the sponsorship and they're flying here, there and everywhere, do the girls actually like have to pay their airfares or accommodation or whatever themselves or is that sponsored similar to the men?
Last year we were very lucky, we only had to pay $100.
For the whole of the season?
Yeah, for the 10 days. But then the year before that we had to pay $1,000 each. And you think we've worked really, really hard to get where we are. We do train all year round. We have a few weeks off over Christmas. And you think, you know, hopefully we can somehow get out there and say, hey, you know, this, we are the best in South Australia. We're representing our state and somebody help us, you know, play. Because obviously you shouldn't have to pay money to represent
your state. They do it very tough, don't they, Donald?
Very difficult indeed. I admire the women for what they do.
Certainly.
And to continue in. Chi-Chi, just on a personal note, a lot of girls from South Australia and Australia, of course, have gone over to Europe and also to the USA. Do you have any personal ambitions?
I did want to go to the USA to try college. But a lot of girls around me have gone over, and I don't know if it is a benefit or not. I'm not really quite sure. I've been overseas I went over for 3 months to play in Canada. Unfortunately for me, it wasn't a great experience. The club wasn't very organised, so... I guess everyone has different things like that, but for now I'm focused on being here and obviously because I'm not playing at the moment, working on my rehabilitation and getting back out there and playing National League, hopefully.
So I suppose, Gigi, you've got to work out the financial reward side of it, don't you, really? I mean, if you're only going to be earning, say, $50,000 over in America and you've got your job and plus your family, friends, climate and whatnot here, then you've really got to weigh up whether or not it's worth going over there or whether you stay here.
It's definitely different for men and women. Like, men can make a career out of this, and for us girls, we're out there, you know, purely because we love it and there's no money involved. And hopefully, you know, maybe the pro league in the US will kick back up again and so the girls can have the opportunity.
Chi-Chi, we see Tommy Sermani, the national coach of a women.
Great guy, really great guy.
Terrific guy. And of course, Adrian Santrak from Adelaide was a previous coach as well. Can you see the day in the next few years that a woman might be coaching the national team?
I'm not sure if it will be a woman being head coach of the team. I don't know. I'm not sure about that. But I think maybe part of the coaching staff, there'll be another female or there'll be a female coaching. That'll be really good, I think, for the girls to have that as well.
So. Okay, now we better have a look at the Kilmaid Premier Division Cup results for the women's.
We've run out of time, so we'll just look at the Premier results, which is they're divided up into two groups, Group A and Group B. In Group A, we had Fulham defeating Adelaide Olympic 2-0 and Adelaide City defeating Gawler 5-3. And in Group B, Cumberland defeated Metro United 3-1, which was a great win there by Cumberland. And the Sturt Marion and Campbelltown City game was postponed, and Parahills had the bye. Any other results, just go on to the Saucer website, www.sawsa.com.au.
And if anyone would like to get in contact with Saucer to maybe look at sponsoring the girls, I'm sure that they would appreciate it. It's just talking to Chi Chi tonight, it's absolutely incredible what
they do. It tough, they but. Look, they do it tough, but it is, look, they are making inroads. It is, much younger sport than the men. So, I mean, we can only hope that with this competition coming to Hindmarsh in the next couple
even
of months...
Even just some supporters at the games.
Definitely.
I'm going to
be
there.
We will definitely be promoting it, and we will promote it for everyone to go along and watch.
Chi Chi May from SASI and from the Adelaide Sensation, thank you for coming in to Full On Football. It's been a pleasure
me.
To have you in here, and all the best in your recovery, and get back on the paddock soon.
We'll do. Sorry for talking so much.
Thank you very much.
That was Chi Chi May from SASI. You're watching Full On Football. After the break, we'll have Shaun Nelligan, the chairman of Parafield Garden Soccer Club. We'll be back with Full On Football.
Do you want to be a part of Full On Football? We are always looking for businesses and organisations to join us in bringing all the local football news to our viewers. So if you'd like to assist us with financial sponsorship or provide goods or services for our competitions and special segments, contact us on 0421 507 948 or send us an email to adamna@optusnet.com.au. We'd love to have you on board.
Parkdale's a different place since we got the Bendigo Bank here. This strip is three times as busy and none of the shops are vacant anymore. And because the profits are ploughed back into our community, we're really seeing the benefits. Banking with the Bendigo paid for this community bus. So if your community wants a bank, there's only one bank you need to know. You need to know the Bendigo.
Welcome back to Full On Football. We're now turning our attention to the Amateur League, and this segment is proudly brought to you by Bendigo Bank. We have a special guest this evening. He's from Parafield Gardens. He's the chairman. They're celebrating their 40th year. And it's a good evening to Shaun Nelligan. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thanks very much for having me here today. Thanks for that.
Shaun, 40 years, humble beginnings for Parafield Gardens, but I believe you're going back to your old heritage strips this year.
Yeah, we decided to go back to the old vertical long sleeve stripe, so it's been a big hit with the fans.
And have they got them in extra large? Because I'd imagine a couple of the players wouldn't like the body hugging strips with the long sleeves on them.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
How's the season started off for you? I know you're sitting second on the ladder at the moment, but how's the season been so far?
Yeah, it's pretty good. We're 3-1-1 with 10 points. I think we're second on the ladder. So, yeah, it's been a good start by the boys. Got a couple of big games coming up, and sort of I think that'll determine where we finish. Really.
Now Parafield have got a proud history. Would you like to share some of your some of your achievements over the past 40 years? That there's a couple there that are of note in the 70s.
Oh, definitely. You know, the 70s was a huge for our club. In I think 75, we were the only club to do the double in both the reserves and the first team. Mm-hmm. So that still hasn't been done today. But you know, it is a proud club. It's a great club to be associated with. And I think we're second to the Vale, Elizabeth Vale, who were in the inaugural year in 65. We started in 66. We play them Sunday. So, but there's a great rivalry there.
Sean, you must be delighted this season, second top in the league this early. Do you have any ex-players that have played in the local competition, as in the Premier League, or the Super League, we call it nowadays. Any name players we could look forward to seeing in Parafield Gardens?
Oh, look, that's probably the thing with us. There is a lot of guys that have played state level. Most of them have at one stage or another, but there's a couple of guys to look out for. One guy who come off the street this year, our forward, Muhammad Ibrahim. He's just a quality striker. I think he scored two on the weekend, and he's just an exciting player. I think he played Division 4 last year, and he's certainly come up to the front. Yeah.
The amateur league obviously attract a lot of spectators. I've got a team at the bottom of my street where there's a lot of people go to see. Parafield Gardens, what's their attendance roughly?
Parafield Gardens have always had the biggest crowd in the league. We've got fantastic crowd support, the zoo as they call them.
noisy.
I think, it definitely would be us and Elizabeth Downs that would have the biggest crowd support. We play the Downs 2 weeks' time, and that'll be a huge game down at Lagana Park. There'll be a massive crowd there, in the thousands. It can get up to that.
Okay. Sean, stay with us. We'll have a look at Donald, the Saturday Division 1 results for Round 5, if you'd like to go through those for us.
Yes, Round 1, of course. Boza 1, Old Ignatians 1, Stirling 7, Comets 1, St. Peter 3, The Cove 1, Modbury Jets 0, Adelaide Uni 5, and Stewart 2, Gleeson 2.
We have a look at the ladder there. Adelaide Uni Lions on top on 13, St. Peter equal with St. Peter's on 13, just goal difference separating those two teams. Stirling on 11, Sturt on 10, Bozza, Old Ignatius on 7, Gleeson on 4, Azar Cove, Moby Jets on 3, and the Comets on 0 points.
Looking now at Saturday Division 2, Flinders Uni 5, Cougars 4, unlucky for Cougars there, they should have got up and at least equalised. Adelaide Uni 1, Griffins 3, Monarchs and Torrens Valley drawing 1-1, Handorf 1, Strathalbyn 6, Adelaide Wanderers, or you'll be happy with this, your mate, 8. They definitely broke the breakers there, 8-0, definitely. Oh my goodness, that's a trouncing. And Adelaide Uni Black 2, MA Hawks 2. And if we look at the ladder there, we can see that the Wanderers are wandering very merrily up top.
Couldn't shut him up at work today, I couldn't. That, I'll tell you, it was like being at home with the wife, I tell you.
Oh, well, you would have loved it then. 15, he was up there on 15 points there. Strathalbyn on 12, Flinders Uni also on 12 with Griffins. MA Hawks and Monarchs on 7, Cougars on 6, Torrens Valley 5, Adelaide Uni Blacks on 4, Adelaide Uni on 3 as with Breakers, and Harmdorf on the 1 point. And we coming to the division that you're interested in.
That's exactly right. AV Metro 4, Salisbury into 1, so Rick Saraccio out there at AV Metro will be no doubt very pleased with that. Parahills West 0, Elizabeth Downs 2, so the Downs continue on their merry way. The big game of the weekend was Parafield Gardens 4, Shaun getting over Elizabeth Vale 1, Florina 3, Royal Park 1, and your team, Nat, USC Lion 6, defeated NAB 2.
Second win in 2 games, oh my goodness, can they take it further?
And if we go to the table, Donald?
Elizabeth Downs played 5 games, 15 points the maximum, then we see Parafield Gardens on 10 points, Salisbury Inter, and also Parahills West on 9 points, AV Metro on 7 points, 3 teams logged together on 6 points, that is USC Lion, Elizabeth Vale and Florina. Second bottom is NAB on 4, and then down at the bottom, Royal Park with 1.
Sean, although you've got the Downs and yourselves, the Gardens, the two front clubs, there's not a lot really between probably 5, 6, 7 clubs in the Sunday Division 1.
No, exactly right. I think the league at the moment is the strongest it's been for a long, long time, and there's not much separating all the clubs really. Metro last year won the title. I think they're having a little bit of a bad run at the moment, but they'll come good. You can mark your words on that, yeah, for sure.
And so, who do you see then as your main rival? Would you for the title? Would you see it as Elizabeth Downs, or do you still think that Metro will be the team to come up and be the one that's challenging at the end of the season?
Look, I think definitely Elizabeth Downs. They've got a fantastic squad, and they're definitely going to be the team to beat. But Metro will come good. Salisbury Inter, you can never write them off. It's going to be a a tussle, definitely.
Now, if people are around the Parafield Gardens area and would maybe like to get involved with your club, how's the best way to go about it?
Well, they can contact the club after seven most weekdays, or go to our website.
Which is?
Well, put you on the spot. You got me here, sorry. Yeah. It's a pgsc@hotmail.com.
Oh, very well done. And the address, where do you play your home games out of? So maybe they could wander down on a Sunday afternoon?
Yeah, we're at Bradman Road, behind the BP Parafield Gun Shops there, Bradman Oval.
And let's not forget, please, Sunday Division 2, because yes, they'll be upset if we don't read their scores out.
I'm just getting Sean in while we've got the opportunity, Nat, that's
okay,
all.
Okay, no problems. We had Mobury Vista on 3, Para Hills East 1, Southern Knights 2, Fulham 1, Bosnia 0, West Beach 2, Pumas 3, Macedonia 1, Ingle Farm 6, getting over Limnos 0. And looking at the ladder?
Yes, Ingle Farm on top on 12 points, West Beach and Mobury Vista on 10, Para Hills East and the Limnos. I said Limos last week, didn't I? Now, but I got it right. Limnos on 9. Fulham 7. Pumas on 6. Southern Knights on 5. Macedonia on 3. And Bosnia bringing up the rear, unfortunately, with just the one solitary point.
Before you say goodbye to our guest, I'd actually like to ask him about. I actually went on your website and had a good old laugh looking at some of these photographs from Parafield Gardens Idol in 2004. Ugh. I was tempted to bring some to put them on air tonight, but
actually,
I thought I wouldn't. You had a bit of cross-dressing there?
Yeah, well, the club's got a history of cross-dressing, especially from our club captain, Ray Cole. He's always been seen in the dress, so... No, it's a great night, the players' review. So
it looked like a really fun night, because not only did you have the kids involved, I mean, we had some Elvises there, we had some rappers, we had some topless men's band or something.
Yeah,
I don't know what that was, some band. It looked really great.
Yeah, no, players' reviews, we always have a good old laugh there. It's great fun.
Sean, you said Ray Cool's a captain?
Yeah, Ray Cool's a club captain. He's off to... he's on his way to the World Cup at the moment, so... Yeah, but he's club captain.
And him and his brother have been famous for pushing the amateur league for many, many years. His brother, Jock Cool, who was an excellent player and represented the state many times, as has Ray, of course.
Yeah, well, Ray actually played for the state last year. So, you know, at 40-odd years of age, I mean, that says something about the guy. Mm.
Sean, thanks for coming in to Full On Football. All the best for the rest
thanks
of the season.
Thanks for having us.
And good luck.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
That was Sean Nelligan, the Parafield Gardens chairman of Sunday Division 1 amateur side. Coming back after the break, we'll have bits and pieces. You're watching Full On Football.
Bianco Building Supplies have been providing quality goods and specialised services to the building industry since 1977. Their staff pride themselves in providing total quality customer service. Whether you require machinery, building supplies, drainage, structural reinforcing steel, or hiring of portable on-site buildings, Bianco's friendly and dedicated staff are only too happy to meet your requirements. And if it's safety products you're after, Bianco Safety have an extensive range to choose from. Their safety van can come direct to you, fit out and supply all your safety needs for your work site. Visit www.bianco.com.au to have a look at their fantastic range of products. Bianco, number one for all your building and safety supplies.
Welcome back, and we're now at the end of the show where we're going to wrap up with our bits and pieces. First of all, we'd just like to say, remind you all that we're going to be out at, our cameras will be out at the Super State League game, NAB v Strikers, because we like to give everyone a go here on Full On Football. Secondly, I'm a bit disappointed. Going to be pointing my finger at all you players out there. We've been asking you to send in your photos for Mother's Day together. Take a photo with your mother. And look, I don't want to swear. We've only had a couple of people send in photos. And I'm just trying to think, why was that? Because your mothers didn't do it for you. So now it's time to get off your backsides and do this for your mother, to say happy Mother's Day for her, and take the photograph, send it into Mother's Day Photos, Full On Football, PO Box 319, Henley Beach 5022, or email it to us at admna@optusnet.com.au. And I would like to see a few more than two or three next time I speak. Also, if you'd like to send us any information about your club, about things that are coming up, about you might see a great superstar out there playing football and you want to tell us about them, please do so. You can do it one of two ways. You can email us on adamna@optusnet.com.au or send it into our post office box, Full On Football, PO Box 319, Henley Beach 5022. Take it away, Michael.
Thank you very much, Nat. On tonight's show, we had Ross Aloisi, the captain of Adelaide United Football Club, proudly brought to you by Aloisi Ceramics on Research Road at Paraco. Got a plug in there for you, Roscoe. Carmine Lauriello from the Campbelltown City Red Devils, the assistant coach there. Peter Cristarella, the coach of the Enfield City Falcons. Shaun Claridge, a White City Woodville player from the under-23s. His younger brother, Shannon Claridge, the Western Strikers under-13 player. We had Shaun Nelligan, the chairman of the Parafield Garden Soccer Club. We had Chi Chi May. Thank you, Nat. I hadn't missed that.
The quiet girl that
couldn't
talk. From
the SASI player and Adelaide Sensation. And a big, big thank you to Donald Campbell for coming in to be our guest panellist. Donald, thanks for coming in. It's been a pleasure to have you.
Thanks, Michael. It's been a pleasure being here. It's been a great experience with you and Nat. Two of the professionals of the local television. No, it's tremendous to you what you guys have done for
Thanks,
the game.
Thanks, Donald. Hopefully we'll catch up with you
really
in the near future.
Really appreciate your time, Donald. Thank you. I'm very happy that you came along tonight.
Thanks for coming in. Remember to, if you missed the show tonight, on Wednesday nights, remember to catch up on Saturday mornings from 9:30. You wake up with Nat at 9:30 in your
and
bedroom.
And you think you're in the nightmare, let me tell you.
So make sure you're watching for that on Saturday mornings. From that, myself and Donald, remember, don't run on empty, get full on football. See you next week.
See ya. Here we go.